السلام عليكم. Can anyone gain a close relationship or connection with Sayyida Fatima with literature on her, or is it a lot less? Sorry, because the literature on her is a lot less than say on her father, Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم لا سهل إذا ما جعلته سهلا، وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما وفقنا إذا علمتنا. To answer this question, not always the people gain the understanding and knowledge of the others according to their importance or greatness, you know, in this life. The best example of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about many prophets, they are not mentioned in the Holy Quran. We don't know anything about them. It's not because they are not important, okay? To best of my knowledge, we have small collection about Sayyidina Fatima that we are sure about it. We have a large collection there about Sayyidina Fatima that we are not sure about it. I think for such person like me, you know, when I highlighted the personality of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the personality of Sayyidina Khadija, and how she was raised up in this environment, saying that she is the best among all women, you know, this for me is more than enough. Okay. So what I'm trying to say, this is not everything about Sayyidina Fatima. You may know much more about her if you want to be spiritually connected to her. You may consider this as the first step, you know, because now we hear something about Sayyidina Fatima. You have one of your, you know, power given to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been filled with Sayyidina Fatima. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the other part of you, you know, filled with Sayyida Fatima. And for sure, the best among us, those who try to understand what they have heard, and they try to practice according to this, and this, by the expectation, they may be having some spiritual relations with Sayyida Fatima. If you want me, I'm not here to tell stories, you know, but I know about some righteous or pious women, you know, back in Syria and elsewhere, you know, who have regular meeting, you know, with Sayyidina Fatima, you know, in dreams or in other setting, you know, and this is completely possible to happen.
Would it be better for the women to stay at home and look after the family, or go out to work? And in what circumstances can she go out to work?
We answered this question in detail yesterday, you know, because we have this about marriage, and I'm going to be too brief, you know, in this answer. The Prophet ﷺ said, addressing the woman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you the permission to go out for your needs. Okay, what I understand this hadith by, that without need, which is much more strict circle than just to have fun or to visit so and so or whatever. The need, when you have something needed, you know, for you really, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the permission to women to go outside in this matter. I may not have it available, you know, but this is in my mind, this is the best standard that you have. For women to go outside and work, originally, no. If there's any necessity or need for this, according to this hadith, she may be permitted to go out.
Why is it difficult for women nowadays to follow the traits and characteristics of Sayyida Fatima?
To be honest with you, because the woman has been treated badly and unjustly. Okay. And for the last 100 years or so, I feel sorry, you know, about the woman, because they changed the nature of the woman, the look to the woman. And I used to live in US, you know, and I observed a movie there, you know, from 1920. At that time in US, The woman, they used to have something to cover her hair, the hair. Okay, so here we really we moved a lot, you know, against the nature, the human nature of the woman, and the one who was affected badly by this, even though they may think not. I think the woman, not the man. Okay, the man, they are affected. The men, they are affected by this. But the woman, they are the worst one, you know, to get affected, you know, by this movement, which usually they put for it a name of freedom or being equal to the man or this or that, you know. This not the problem of the woman. Even we suffer this problem, you know, when we read about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when we read about the male's companion radiallahu ta'ala anhum, we find it too difficult, you know, to try to match their life, to live this life. And we share the same problem. This is maybe much more difficult for the woman, you know, because of what I have explained to you. But to be honest with you, this is not impossible. I was in New York City, in Manhattan. Okay, just imagine when I say so. And you have a Japanese woman there who did not know anything about religion. And she became Muslim. And she just opened her eyes, you know, and she had the black gloves, you know, this in Manhattan, you know, of Japanese woman, you know. And what impressed me a lot, you know, about that particular woman, in my life, I have seen a lot of women. I have seen a lot of righteous and pious women, but I haven't seen anyone, you know, similar to that particular woman in her love to Allah and get herself detached completely from this life. You know. Really, she reminded me of Sayyidi Rabi'a al-Alami. To be honest with you, I have seen a lot of righteous and pious women. But like this woman, the Japanese one in Manhattan in New York, I have never seen. Okay, this just to tell me and everyone that it's possible to happen in our time. It's going to be rare, too rare. It's going to be difficult. I know, and I did not speak with that woman, you know, about her difficulties, you know, but I expect that she had a lot of difficulties in her life, okay? But she's still there, you know, she's still standing there. And really, when I tell you, take my word, she impressed me a lot, you know, about her love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which I never experienced in any woman, you know, in our time, at all, okay? And this is, could be the done. Yani all of us, we face a lot of difficulties. Sometimes, out of our weakness, we may adjust ourselves, you know, here or there, you know. But let's at least upgrade our standard, okay? Don't have your standard equal to the people of your time, okay? Because in my scale, I don't look at this as a best standard to have, okay? The Prophet ﷺ described his nation in one time as Husala. That's mean this the worst thing, you know, to be described by, you know. And by this, if you don't like to be Husala, you should upgrade your standard, you know. And here, alhamdulillah, we have that chance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not prevent us, you know, of having that chance to listen to such description, you know, of high figure like Sayyidi Fatima. We should love these standards. We should work hard, you know, to get closer to this standard as much as we can.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Salaam.
I heard some narrations about the relationship between Sayyida Fatima and her husband, Sayyidina Ali. In the beginning, Sayyida Fatima did not like her husband. Is this true? Also, was there a big age gap between Sayyida Fatima and Sayyidina Ali?
For the first component of the question, I read this narration. I don't know how accurate is it. You know, apparently, Sayyidina Ali was not one of the best, you know, nice looking from outside. He was a tough person, you know. And some of these tough person, you know, he may have some, you know, obesity or have this or that, you know. And I heard this narration, you know, or I read it, you know, that she complained to the Prophet and he gave her the non-physical description of Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib about his knowledge, about his belief, about his high spiritual state, and you name it, okay? And I don't know how accurate. I don't look at it as she hated or she disliked him, you know. Perhaps يعني she is a woman, still a woman, you know, and the woman may look to have certain description, you know, from the other side, you know, which was not meant, you know, to start with, you know. And this is what we have been speaking, you know, about this morning, you know, when the Sayyida Fatima feel hungry, she doesn't know the meaning of having full stomach. When she doesn't have that nice dress, she doesn't know about the nice dresses. When she doesn't have that perfect house, she did not know about the perfect house, and you name it. When she was tired, she did not know about the rest, you know, and how to have calm area. All those things, they are well known to her, but she is one of the best one, you know, to understand the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this life, and why we are present here. We are present here not to make everything, you know, easy and available to us. We are present here to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to start with, to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have very strong connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by this, you may expect, again, don't take my word. I don't know how confirmed is this point, you know. I have read some narration that she complained about some physical description of Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib at the beginning. What was this?
Age difference.
The age difference, no age difference, you know. Even though if there's age difference, you know, none of them complained to us, you know, about the age difference. And even she passed away years, many years, you know, before Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib. We have a lot of controversy about her age and Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib age. According to the most authentic one, that means there's 5 years gap, you know, between them, not more.
If a woman is married to an Ahlul Bayt, how should she treat her husband and children with regards to their status as being honored as Ahlul Bayt?
I had this experience, you know, when I was single, you know, that I look forward to get married to one of the Ahlul Bayt. And one of the shuyukh, he told me, you think it's easy when you get married to one of the people in Ahlul Bayt? You should have much more responsibility, much more duty, much more respect, and you name it, you know. And we hear a lot of these stories, you know, very nice and very impressive, you know, story about people, how they used to respect, you know, the people of Ahlul Bayt. And here, let's have this example, you know, from Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib. Whenever he had any problem, Sayyidina Fatima, I tell you, this is going to shed more light, you know, about whenever he had any problem with Sayyidina Fatima, he will not argue, he will not complain, he will go outside and put some soil, you know, on his head. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam right away is going to know that there's something wrong, you know, and he will try to fix it, sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Is it true that Sayyida Fatima never wore gold?
Never
wore gold.
We hear again, this is I think sound or authentic one, that the Prophet entered the house of Sayyida Fatima one day when she had a golden thing, you know, put in her neck or whatever, you know, and his holy face changed, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this was well known from him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he's too sincere. Whenever he feels something bad, it's going to be shown right away on his face. And if we are familiar with this, no doubt Sayyidina Fatima is going to be much more familiar than us with this, you know. And she did know exactly what's going on with the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And she sold that one, you know, the golden one, and paid it as a charity or something of this regard, and the Prophet ﷺ was too happy about her behavior in this regard. Yes, if you go by this narration, yes, that means she did not use the gold.
How can we encourage our children to do well in their studies?
Yeah. I'm not that expert in what to raising up children and have this and that, you know. Perhaps I am not designed, you know, of these matters, you know. I look at the parents, you know, as the model of their children. Whatever you want of them, try to practice it in yourself. When they look at you as a serious person, you know, in taking care of your duties, you know, they will be serious at taking care of their duty. When they look at you, you take it easy, you go late to that appointment, and you don't fix your timetable, you know, and job, you know, and this and that problem. Regardless how much you are going to tell them to be good in their education and study, they will not listen to you. They learn the trick from you, you know, to speak something, you know, and behave something else. You know. So whenever you are honest with yourself, sincere with yourself, this is going to affect your children. If they love you a lot, this is going to affect them significantly and make them go the way you want.
Sayyidah Fatima had many good qualities. Which was the greatest?
In my opinion, I may be right or wrong, as I said, when she was called Ummu Abiha, that means she collected all those good characters, you know, of her father.
Any more questions? Questions from the floor?
Some people were written on the web that she was protecting her house from saying that someone tried to attack her.
Yes, and we have a lot of these fake stories. This, yani here, if you have this narrated in Bukhari, which is not the case, okay? If you have this story narrated in Bukhari, about يعني, the person who did so according to this narration, Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab. If you try to compare it with the other behaviors of Umar al-Khattab, it's not going to fit with any of his behavior, okay? يعني here, take it logically, okay? Then don't take it emotionally. You have a pile of data tells you how Umar al-Khattab used to love Al-Bayt. How he used to love the Prophet ﷺ, the head of Ahlul Bayt. So, when you have this story, if it's narrated in Bukhari, it's not going to fit, it's not going to contradict the other. Yet, to best of my knowledge, it's completely fake, okay? And those poor people who narrated this story, to your surprise, and to my surprise when I read it, you know, they are liars, not in our books, they are liars in their books. Okay? So, a chain of liars, you know, by themselves, they said they are liars. I'm going to attack and look badly to Umar bin Khattab according to this. This doesn't make any sense, okay? We should be fair, you know, in this matter. And to be honest with you, this is personal thing, you know, this is from my side, you know. I think those people who think so, they put Sayyidina Fatima down. Why? Because they said in this fake story that he came in, you know, and he beat her up and she aborted. And I, in my view, look at Sayyidina Fatima as beloved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to that extent. Will not let her go to those humiliating, you know, positions, you know, as mentioned, okay? We have some humiliation done to the Prophet ﷺ when he was in Mecca, but even the Prophet ﷺ, he was not exposed to such a position, you know, to have like this humiliating matter, you know, to have, yani, we don't accept it nowadays, you know, a woman, you know, to have a stranger come to her, beat her up, you know, and make her aborted, you know, and any of those fake, you know. So I think those people, you know, they are not that good, you know, in faking this story, you know, because I look at them as putting Sayyidina Fatima down, you know, because in my view, in my scale, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not let Sayyidina Fatima go by those humiliating positions or situation mentioned in that fake narration. And كنت سيدنا علي بن أبي طالب ده. يعني I myself, I'm not brave. سيدنا علي used to be brave and strong. I'm not brave neither strong, okay? But I imagine myself, I'm going to kill myself before having anyone touch my wife. Okay, and Sayyidina Ali ibn Talib, again in this fake story, is very weak and very, and it was put down, you know, this person who beaten up his wife, you know, and make her aborted. He gave bay'ah to him. He said, I want to marry your daughter. He said, yes, Hadar Sayyidi, you are going to marry my, يعني, this is the picture of Sayyidina Ali ibn Talib. You don't like it for yourself, you know. How do you like it to Sayyidina Ali ibn al-Talib? You see, يعني here doesn't fit for Sayyidina Fatima and doesn't fit for Sayyidina Ali ibn al-Talib. If they don't like Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab, there's complete inconvenience between this story, you know, and the personality of Sayyidina Fatima and the personality of Sayyidina Ali ibn al-Talib.
Salam, respected
Shaykh.
Did Sayyidina Ali ibn al-Talib remarry after Sayyidina Fatima's death?
Yeah, he has a lot of wives, you know, after the Sayyidina Fatima. One of them, Sayyidina Fatima instructed him, if I pass away, get married to my niece. It's called Umama, okay? Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib married her according to the advice of his wife.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh. To what degree and how should women in the West follow the sunnah of Sayyidina Fatima, dress, etc., as we are living in completely different times. Also, what is the role of men in helping women to do this?
Here, all of us, we should recognize what's an obligation or compulsory, what's a recommended thing, what is better to be done. Okay? So here, for me, it's out of question, it's out of discussion, you know, to speak about the obligations, the compulsory. If you imagine, or some of you imagine, that I have the authority here to say about some thing which has been obliged by Allah to say, it's, you are permitted not to do it. No, I'm not this person. Okay? Here, we don't compromise, you know, about these matters. Okay? About the others, the Prophet ﷺ used to make it easy on his nation. He loved many actions a lot, but he doesn't want to make it heavy or a burden on his nation. That's why he tried to change his pattern, change his habit, change his attitude all the time, not to let anyone, you know, say this is tradition from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you should do it. Okay, here when you speak about Sayyidina Fatima as a personality, for sure there's something obliged there and should be done, and when we don't do it, we are going to be deficient, you know, in this regard. We may be sinful, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness. Other things, you know, we are speaking about very unique and high level. This should be our example, should be our model, and we should work hard to reach it, you know, regardless of how good or how bad we are in our practice, okay? This should be our aim, for sure. Whenever you find it's too difficult, you know, if it's not an obligation or compulsory, you may bypass it, you know, but you tell yourself, I am a bad person here.
Any more questions from the floor?
How can we make rooted in our house a breeding ground for people like Sayyidina Imam Hussein and Sayyidina Bint Ali? What are the ingredients that make these great personalities or bring them to that corner? What's the ingredients apart from Zohar, which is Zohar?
May I ask you a question before answering a question? Why will you mention Sayyidina Hussein highly respected and Sayyidina Zainab not the others?
Just the teaching of Sayyidina Fatima.
And I did not get the significance, you know. They are from Sadatina al-Bayt, okay. Why they were mentioned specifically?
Did you know Sayyidina Fatima brought them up in certain ways that they were great personalities in Islam, and they are the children of Sayyidina Fatima. I also mean about Hassan and, you know, the other children, but I was just curious, what were the motherly regularly think that maybe...
I was mentioning Hanafi book. I'm going to answer from Hanafi book, okay? If you want to mention the killing of Sayyidina al-Husayn, you are not permitted till you mention the killing of Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab, the killing of Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, the killing of Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, and then you mention the killing of Sayyidina al-Husayn. That's what mentioned in the Hanafi book, okay? And I take it from this point, okay? Here, as an emotion, as a personal life, some of us may love some of these persons, you know, much more than Sayyidina Abu Bakr and Sayyidina Umar. It's a possibility, okay? But here, to make it as a way of living in this life, you know, and convey it to your children, this is, in my view, it's completely wrong, okay? We should have it in a well-balanced way, okay? I told you about how I look at it, you know, from the well-balanced way, and our love to Al-Bayt and our love to the companion. Whenever you feel you are in the balanced way, I have no problem with it, you know. When I say, see it as deviated, I have a problem with it, okay? And that's why I did not, perhaps I did not understand the question very well, you know. When you have these two holy names, you know, and highly respected, you know, I felt the question as deviated question, not straight one. This is in my feeling, I might be completely wrong.
What is the view of women wearing niqab in the West, especially if it attracts negative views from those who find it alien?
Now, يعني, I would like everyone to recognize when I say this is narration, when I say this is my input, okay? My input, you know, in this matter, the woman, when she get outside, she should have the least way or the minimum way of making the other looking at her. In some countries, if you want me, I'll name, you know, in Saudi Arabia, when the woman uncover her face, is going to be looked, you know, strongly by everyone. And I think in such an environment, she should cover her face, okay? Whereas here in the US, it may be, don't take my word, not here, in US, sometimes perhaps in some areas or some community, when she cover her face, is going to have the more attraction, you know, and more look, you know. If she did not have this, she may not. This is, don't mix it with the obligation to cover her hair. This is an obligation, okay? No, it's out of discussion. But to cover her face, since we have controversy among the scholars, the way I would like any woman to act, you know, in this matter, to make it in the way, make the people, you know, looking at her the least number, the minimum number.
Okay. This question, I apologize, I didn't really understand it very well. Please, can you clarify if this sign called Hand of Fatima has anything to do with Sayyida Fatima, and is this acceptable? Sometimes it has an eye in the middle.
I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with it, you know. I have seen many of pictures or things, you know, which I think they are fake, but I have no idea about this, you know. If anyone has better idea, let him, you know, show. I don't know, you know. And Sayyida Fatima, I don't expect that she did show her, you know, face or her hand to anyone, you know, and she doesn't like her hand to be shown to anyone.
Any other questions?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. How did Sayyida Fatima pass away? Was it from natural causes? And how old was she?
Apparently, it was natural causes, you know. I don't remember exactly if they mentioned about certain disease or not. About her age, again, we have a lot of controversy. When you calculate it, you know, according to what I felt is the most accurate, if you have 18 years and 11, she was roughly around less than 30, 29 years old.
No, there's an issue that I don't know much about in the shed life, because I'm saying that I didn't ask for another woman's hand during the life of the
So what's that question?
If you could clarify what happened and what the message is.
As narrated in Bukhari, the Prophet said that Ali ibn Abi Talib has a proposal, you know, to get married to the daughter of Abi Jahl. I am not here to make the halal haram, to prohibit what's permitted or to permit what's prohibited, but I say, that's what the Prophet said, I say that you will not have the daughter of the enemy of Allah and the daughter of the beloved one of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gathered in one house, okay? And this, as mentioned by many scholars, you know, anyone who get married to the daughter of the Prophet is not permitted to combine or have another wife with him. This is the opinion of most scholars. They mention it in Shama'il al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. About Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, as soon as he heard this from the Prophet, he said, I'm not going to do anything which make you unpleasant with me or make you unsatisfied with me.
So did after she passed away, he married the same woman? After Sayyidina Fatima passed away, did he marry the woman?
No. To best of my knowledge, no. I have read you about the wives of Sayyidina Ali. I'm not certain now, but I say 90%, no, he did not get married to that particular woman. I don't expect so, you know, that the companion they use, whenever they have anything of that, you know, they get away, far away of those marriages. You know, and that's what happened to Sayyidina Ali. Even this, yani, which is, you see, this tell you about the fake matter. You have two different or three, or you may have more, you know, of them, you know that they are in adultery.
Any more questions?
Yes.
Any more questions?
Okay, here, Sayyidina Nuruddin asked to, or some of the audience, because we hadith musalsal bil awwalay, but unfortunately for you, it's not going to be the first, because I mentioned some ahadith, you know, before. I'll give you this as riwayah, you know. This is it's called musalsal bil awwalay. Musalsal, what does it mean? When you have the certain statement given by each narrator, or certain action, certain movement given by each narrator, and or certain description, and here you have the description. This is the first hadith ever I have heard from so-and-so. And this, the chain, it goes from me to my sheikh all the way to Sufyan ibn Uyayna. Everyone will say, this is the first hadith I ever heard from this person. It stopped at Sufyan ibn Uyayna. This was not his first hadith to hear from Amr ibn Dinar, his sheikh. Amr ibn Dinar is not first hadith to hear, or we don't know, of Qabus Mawla Abdullah ibn Amr. And this is not the first, to best of our knowledge, not the first hadith to be heard from Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, when he narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ar-Rahimun yarhamuhumur Rahmanu tabaraka wa ta'ala. Irhamu man fil ard, yarhamkum man fil sama. This is the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that you should narrate. What is it? الراحمون يرحمهم الرحمن تبارك وتعالى ارحموا من في الأرض يرحمكم من في السماء. This is the companion of this hadith is Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. His student is Qabus. His student is Amr ibn Dinar. His student Sufyan ibn Uyayna. Then the student of Sufyan ibn Uyayna, this was the first hadith to be heard from Sufyan ibn Uyayna all the way to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Thank you very much, sincerely, from everyone of Luton and all the around the areas who did come to hear you today. It was an honour for you to come to get you to share your wealth of knowledge. Alhamdulillah, you can see brothers making notes. Alhamdulillah. So, inshallah, I just want to thank you, brothers and sisters, also for attending. It's been an absolute pleasure to host this for some of you guys. I just want to quickly go back and emphasise. I know time's running short, and obviously. On the 313 campaign, brothers and sisters, the sheets are there. if you could humbly put your details, if you could be committed to donate that £10 to support what you've seen today. The proof of the pudding is what you've seen today, and more sessions and lectures like this, it would be great. I really, really, really want to put a big emphasis on the 313 project and just donate, brothers and sisters. You're not going to get poor, despite whatever the shouting or whispers in your ears, you are not going to afford £10. You know,